reviewing a non-fiction book for the first time, The Sickness Unto Death by Soren Kierkegaard. I've certainly not read my fair share of non-fiction, and it's only now that I'm slowly starting to understand why. The thing about non-fiction, especially if it's gloomy and existentialist, is that it requires a certain level of mental energy to get through, something that I need to create myself and that doesn't happen on its own. And whenever I read non-fiction like this, I make myself very anxious because I feel like I don't know much about the author, his or her philosophy, their roots, their ideas and stuff like that. But this is exactly what I'm trying to change. Reading comes very naturally. It's a part of what I do every day. So the idea is to just read and forget about everything else. So anyway, about Soren Kierkegaard, I read on the first page of this book that he was born in 1813, and just before he turned 22 years old, he lost his mother and his five siblings, except for one brother and his father. So I was very surprised to know how closely associated he was with death from such a young age. This is my first Soren Kierkegaard book, and it's only after reading The Sickness Unto Death have I developed a keen interest in his philosophy. So I intend on reading Either Or and Fear and Trembling next. It was very fascinating for me to read about the self from such a philosophical point of view, because I've always read about consciousness from a psychological perspective, that is from Carl Jung's perspective, for example, the four archetypes and even the man and his symbols. Sometimes what happens is you think you understand a particular concept or idea, but what's actually happening is you're just limiting your perspective by feeding yourself all this information through the same lens. So for me, Soren Kierkegaard created a whole new lens altogether. In the book, he goes on to explain how when you compare being a human being with a house consisting of a basement, ground floor and first floor, how we living in this house that belongs to us still prefer to live in the basement. I mean, it is your building, these are your levels of sensation, yet you love the comfort and security of your basement so much that you find it displeasing whenever anyone suggests you occupy the fine suite. The despair mentioned umpteen number of times in this book is not a form of physical illness. Rather, it's suggestive of how mortally ill we are and how we carry this loss of self, this illusion of defeating the negative, the weakness, unto death. To be honest, at this point, the book is not wholly fatalistic. Soren Kierkegaard also talks about how despair is not always something that reaches you from the outside world. It's an extended form of self-activity, an action in the form of reflection of oneself to oneself. You know, you despair in weakness, you despair in self-assertiveness, you despair in not wanting to be yourself, and you despair in wanting to be yourself. That's how infinite the whole idea is and how vast the spiritual sense of the self. Why should you read this book even if you've never read anything like it before? Because Soren Kierkegaard never wrote for money. He always wrote to save himself and humanity. He's the essence of all philosophy, especially existentialism. You read the book and by the end of it, you're sure to gain a deeper, more abstract understanding of the self. And you know that the fact that to despair is not a problem that demands a solution. It's only a natural part of your consciousness. I know I can write a thesis on this book. That's how much I enjoyed reading it, and I'm eagerly looking forward to his other works, Either Or, Fear and Trembling, and also The Concept of Anxiety. I'll end the video on this note. This is Amreen from Read A Day Club, and if you haven't subscribed to our monthly newsletter, then please do. We talk about all sorts of books and even movies that make an impact in some way or the other.